So I'm, in case you don't know me, I'm Eve Zimmerman, director of the Newhouse Center, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to our second Newhouse Faculty Fellows Lecture and Discussion of 2019. Professor Nikki Greene, Art Department, spent the summer of 2019 here in her Newhouse office. Not only did I enjoy her warm presence, she brought us fame and maybe one day fortune through the medium of the daily shot, which I understand is now being studied in art departments across the country. No, I'm joking. Nikki is finishing up her new book, Grime, Glitter, and Glass, The Body and the Sonic in Contemporary Black Art, which is currently under contract at Duke University Press. I quote, the book presents a new interpretation of the work of Renee Stout, María Magdalena Campos-Pons, and Radcliffe Bailey, and considers the intersection between the body, black identity, and the sonic possibilities of the visual, using key examples of painting, sculpture, photography, performance, and installation. Today, I believe we will hear about the second figure, María Magdalena Campos-Pons. I personally, if I may say so, am eager to hear more about the links between the sonic and the visual. Walking into any recently built museum, Titanic Museum in Belfast, that was thanks to Kelly Carter-Jackson, another Newhouse Fellows suggestion. And yesterday, the African American History and Culture Museum in Washington, D.C., you can see how curators are trying to give the sonic its due. But for a rigorous theoretical explication of the sonic possibilities of the visual, we will soon be able to turn to Professor Greene's book. It promises to be a major contribution to the field. Professor Greene came to Wellesley in 2013. She's held a number of prestigious fellowships, a Mellon Postdoctoral Fellowship, the Woodrow Wilson Career Advancement Fellowship, and the Richard D. Cohen Fellowship at the Hutchins Center for African and African American Research at Harvard University. A fact that I didn't know, Nikki was also an artist in residence at the U-Cross Foundation in Wyoming in spring 2019. Finally, in the interest of time, I'll just give you a couple of Nikki's recent journal publications to give you a sense of her breadth and depth as a scholar. Vibrations in the Soul, Mo Brooker's Sacred Paintings, Riffing the Index, Romare Bearden, thank you. And The Hand of Jazz. And her course titles, African Art and the Diaspora, The Body, Race and Gender in Modern and Contemporary Art, African American Art, and the list seems to go on and on. Without further ado, I give you Professor Nikki A. Greene.
So I hope that the video wasn't terribly distracting. I left it up there deliberately because I think we're constantly being bombarded by both the visual and the audio, sometimes in very distracting ways. And so this is sort of a test of your ability to kind of pay attention to me while also paying attention to the wonderful artist you see here, María Magdalena Campos-Pons. What you are seeing, what I decided to do was to play part of the, well, this is getting pretty far into the performance of Remedios that she performed at the Peabody Essex Museum, and it is the performance that I'll be highlighting for today. But no worries, I will be changing that out. I do have quite a bit of media, multimedia. It's sort of how I've functioned in art history for a very, very long time. And it started off as early as an undergraduate at Wesleyan University, and I was a major in art history. I had never shook it. And I was interested very early on in the murals of Aaron Douglas and how he interpreted jazz of the time. And I stayed committed to this somehow throughout graduate school, and it's going to be really great once this book is out and sort of get it out my system a little bit. Grime, Glitter, and Glass is really my way of summarizing a lot of the investigations that I've made about how does the black body show up in visual art, and then also considering how then can we think about music, the sonic, the aural, how can all of those things come together in creative ways. I promise you, in part, it takes a long time because I'm dealing with very different genres, very different disciplines. But somehow, some way, this has always sort of gone hand in hand for me. I wasn't able to play an instrument growing up. My parents couldn't afford to afford my lessons, but so I played violin for like a month, and then forced my children to do it. So, you know, that's what it's about, you know, the things you can't do yourself, you make your children do for you. But I sang for most of my time, and really, it was only until I got to graduate school, I kind of, and so my singing has transformed, I think, into the writing and speaking. And the book, very, very briefly, it will highlight Renee Stout, María Magdalena Campos-Pons, and Radcliffe Bailey. And the title has changed as I've switched around titles, switched the order of the artists. And I've switched them around because I've tried to figure out how can I make them all kind of sing together? How can I make them sound off one to one another? And I winded up moving Magda, is what most people call her. I wind up moving Magda to the end because she is the one, while I investigate music throughout, she's the one who is the most performative in her work. It sort of goes right hand in hand with what she does. But very briefly, I'm gonna just show you a little bit, just one comparison here with Renee Stout, someone who I've worked on since meeting her in graduate school in 2002. And I was very interested in how music was really an influence in her life. And she, honestly, I don't think she had thought about it until I asked her. But she mentioned Betty Davis to me, who was one of Miles Davis's wives. And she is primarily responsible for his, primarily responsible for his change from over into the electric. And she was a rock singer. She was really, really out there with her sexuality. In fact, it was when I arrived here as a postdoc that I began to work on Betty Davis and pushed out an article on it. And it's been really fun to understand how black feminists, visual arts and music could be considered. And so having both of these women be people who use their bodies physically in order to kind of create a more kind of outrageous at times, but also something that could make people think more carefully about what the power of black women's bodies could do. That's just sort of a very short version of a very long chapter in the book. But Radcliffe Bailey is also someone I've been considering a lot. I was actually introduced to him because of the show that was here, his retrospective show that was at the Davis Museum in 2012. And I was asked to give a lecture on him, and I realized, oh, he does a lot of the same kinds of things that Renee Stout does. He investigates African cultures and its impact on American culture. And I began to think about how his work would really rhyme well with what I was already interested in particular, thinking about how music would play a part in his work. And it in fact does play a huge part in his work, in particular with someone like Sun Ra. I'm not gonna play any Sun Ra. I've done a lot of presentations and lectures on Radcliffe, but you can see here where one of his seminal works, Windward Coasts, with this glittery head that shines through, how it might be seen as a reflection and an investigation of shine. And so I spent a lot of time thinking about what does shine mean in black culture, and shine as a representation of liminality between earth and water. The idea for a lot of people of color understand this: if you were going out, your mother made sure that your skin was shiny. lotion, Vaseline, everything to make your skin glow, as well as your hair. And you can see here where Sun Ra wears this really shiny cap. And then I got to thinking about Jerry curls and why Jerry curls in the 1980s. Why? Why did they exist? Why did I get one? And it was because of the kind of shine that it gave you. And I do a whole thing about Jerry curl in the book. And I was going to do a lot more about Michael Jackson. I know, right? So Michael is still in the book because I do think that it's important to understand the impact he had on American culture, the music industry. And I was particularly taken with Krista Thompson's book, Shine, The Visual Economy of Light in African Diasporic Practices, and her ideas surrounding the surface. This quote here is from Krista Thompson: the surface of the surface, the effect of light reflecting off of surfaces as a representational space for figuring black subjects. And that continues to be something that really intrigues me, and again, probably a different kind of article spinoff on Michael Jackson is to come after the book, but it's been a lot of fun kind of investigating that. And I should also mention that Radcliffe Bailey is, when he was 19, 20 years old, some of you will remember the song by Arrested Development, Tennessee. Take me to another place, y'all remember that? All the people who were living life good in the 80s and 90s, and primarily 90s, are like, yeah, remember that song. At the end, I don't have a clip of it here, but at the end, Radcliffe Bailey is actually creating a collage in the video. He's actually doing a work of a lynching. And so I wish I brought that, but you can go Google it. It's at the last minute of the video. So I'm doing a lot of understanding the physicality of making work and this kind of rhyming with music and the sonic. But to our star of the day, María Magdalena Campos-Pons. I told Magda that I'm basically her groupie. And I try to, as much as possible, get to the performances if they're within reach, because it really does help me to understand better. And you know that these ephemeral experiences, if you can't be there, you miss so many of the elements of the sounds, the smells, the sights, the movement, and all of that. And I first came across, or first interacted with Magda. I took this photograph in Havana at an artist studio. And it was my first exposure to her outside of exhibition catalogs, including the Black Womanhood catalog that was a show that actually was featured here at the Davis Museum. I know, can you imagine? The Black Womanhood show at the Davis. We gotta kind of figure some other iteration of that here. But being able to be a part of her entourage, as it were, to be able to observe her with fellow artists, to see her shaking and moving in Havana and the art scene was really a game changer for me. And it offered us, I went along with my colleague, the now retired filmmaker Salem Rakuria, and we were able to get this inside look into the arts of Havana and the many, many artists who are working within the city, outside in the country, as well as those who live in two worlds and commuting back and forth between Miami and New York and Los Angeles and other places in the US. So that was my introduction to Magda and seeing her installation at the 11th Havana Biennale. And I continue to follow her career. She's someone I could text at this point. I need a quote. It's funny, so I went to this performance in May 2014, which was a performance done at the Guggenheim during Carrie Mae Weems' retrospective. I do have an essay on that performance in the National Portrait Gallery's Smithsonian Institution book called Beyond the Face, and that considers different kinds of ways that portraiture shows up. And so considering performance as portraiture, and what do you do with a woman who poses as the Guggenheim in the Guggenheim? was really, really fascinating. And I also interrogate the works of Carrie Mae Weems and how Black feminists dialogues help to make their presence known within museums. And of course, every time that Magda performs, I see it as a kind of intervention. And this performance was a really special one in that I was able to be there for the rehearsal. And so being able to see the Duke Ellington High School performers who also surround, they're in the background there in that photograph, along with, I don't know if you can see the trumpeter there, is Terrence Blanchard here, and then Neil Leonard, who is Magda's co-collaborator for many, many years. They met in 1989 and were married, or 1988, and were married soon after that. They only recently divorced, but many of their works that you see here, for example, identified, is authored by both Magda and Neil Leonard. And so what I've appreciated about Magda's work, it's taken me to sort of far-flung places on the globe, including being able to present in Johannesburg. And as you can see there, I have done some work in thinking about sugar in relationship to Carol Walker's installation in Brooklyn, which was called A Subtlety, with a very long title. That's a paragraph long. But thinking about how different artists are interrogating sugar is really, it's a whole book in of itself. There's actually a really great exhibition in California right now that's going on. I can't remember the title off the top of my head, but something like Sugar, Rum, and something else. And I think it's at MOAD, Museum of African Diaspora in San Francisco. And I also had the honor and privilege of traveling to Documenta 14 in Kassel, Germany, and that allowed me an opportunity to see yet another way in which Magda's work and Neil's compositional work come together. I'll come back to Bar Matanzas in just a minute, or a few minutes from now. And what you see there are Neil Leonard there on the far right, and Los Muñequitos de Matanzas there, who flew in by the skin of their teeth, make it to this performance directly from Cuba. It was quite an adventure for them. But nevertheless, I've been so honored to be able to do this work and to be able to consider how performance can take up more space in the canon. I'm actually about to sort of switch gears after the book into curating. And so my next project will be, I will be curating a show on Mo Burka, who's an abstract painter. But I'm also going to be investigating Black performance artists and how they sort of take off in terms of almost a new generation of performance artists who are blooming all across the country. And so as I mentioned, Neil and Magda have been in partnership for many, many years, and they've been able to, I think, transform a kind of space within museums that allow for people to be present in a way that I think is not the same as when you're just looking at a still image, or even if you're looking at a film. What you're seeing there in the background is one of the frames of a Polaroid that Magda did with her and with herself, Neil, and their young son at the time, Arcadio, and he's now, I think, 24 years old and very, very tall. And the Davis Museum actually does have, you can see him here. Is that showing up on your screen? Okay. We actually have, it's called the La Sagrada Familia, or the Sacred Family. There's a set at the Davis Museum as well. And so I have been really kind of with Magda's work, and I think going to the Guggenheim and seeing this extraordinary performance where she's dressed up as the Guggenheim Museum And watching her, and there's some similarities in terms of her performance, as I'll talk about the Peabody Essex Museum performance, that you can gather from something like Habla la Madre, or The Mother Speaks. So here she has a very specific kind of costume. She's holding roses that she does eventually give out. Her attendants in the background are also holding flyers or posters that they give out as well. So there's always a sense of reciprocity involved, or at least allowing for participants or visitors to become participants in some way, whether it's they're receiving gifts or they're tasting things or they're smelling a rose. There's always a multi-sensorial event that happens. You're never meant to just be. I think also it's important to consider how she helps visitors to consider the space that they are occupying. So something like the Guggenheim Museum and its very distinctive circular construction by Frank Lloyd Wright, how the experience of walking around those circular walls and how we're supposed to understand how we look at the art and the impact that it has. What does that mean when she does the same and considers herself the museum, where she calls upon the Orishas, the ancestors, to bless the space, thanking Carrie Mae Weems for, as she says, breaking down the door. Carrie Mae Weems, at this point in 2014, was the first Black woman to have a solo show at the Guggenheim Museum. And it's worth noting that it was also at a much smaller scale than the other venues, although the most important one, mostly because the Italian Futurism show had taken up much of the space. And she did a lot of kind of wacky things in that museum that Magda did, in that they had to be very, 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 very careful about the sound, because the Italian Futurism show had a lot of metal, and so you didn't want those things rattling. But nevertheless, as you can see in that photograph, there was drumming, there were trumpets, there was a full-on Cuban band playing, and one other intervention she did was in that container she has there, she also winds up pouring 7 fish to represent the 7 Orishas into the fountain without permission. They had no idea she was going to do that. but this idea of invading the space, and I will tell you, as someone who has been to a lot of museums, this weekend was spectacular because it was a special special programming weekend that Carrie Mae Weems had organized. And by far, it was the most people of color I'd ever seen at the Guggenheim, and probably ever will until something else like this happens. Maybe the Solange performance may have had more. And for those of you who don't know that, how many of you know about Solange doing her own? Yeah, so Solange took over the museum and did a performance. That's also in the book. But anyway, so the ways in which Magda is able to take over a space and to inject it with ideas of Black feminism, of African diasporic religions, is really key. She's also had world platforms, not just Documenta. She was she represented Cuba for the Venice Biennale in 2013, and as you'll notice there, she is covered in white and she's wearing a Chinese garb. Why she does that is because she does have a maternal great grandmother was Chinese. And for those of you familiar with the Caribbean, Chinese were also brought to the Caribbean as indentured servants and were able to also work side by side with people of African descent and of Indian descent, of all the different cultures that were present throughout the Caribbean. And so she honors that past as well.
Similar to what I was here.
Hold on a second. I'm gonna just go back to the beginning. And
I am lost.
Hold on. So let me first say this. in diving into this particular performance, in preparation for the exhibition Alchemy of the Soul for the Peabody Essex Museum, it opened in January 2016, and in 2015, Magda travels to La Vega, which is in the Matanzas province of Cuba, where she was born and raised. And it was the first time she'd actually gone back to her town. She'd gone back several times, back and forth to Cuba when she was allowed to, but it was the first time she'd gone back home. And La Vega is where she still has family members who still live there. And she went there really to study the ruins of the sugar plantation that she actually grew up on and had left 30 years beforehand. And she confessed that it took coming to America and having a separation from Cuba to look back and kind of, what she says, reframe and refocus everything. And in La Vega, Campos-Pons' family cultivated sugar for generations. And since slavery was abolished in Cuba in 1886, I don't know, a lot of people don't know that Cuba was very late in the process of abolishing slavery, which meant that her grandfather, who actually was born in Nigeria and brought to Cuba very late, she knew him. So the idea of slavery, of enslaved Africans, was not this distant, far away, generational thing. It was very, very much present. And in fact, actually it was her great-grandfather, and she actually grew up on the plantation, within the barracks of the slave plantation. So the kind of memory and connection that she has to the land is really quite palpable. And so as a recognition of the labor of the many members of her family in Cuba and of the toil of black bodies within the Americas in general, and of those who endured the Middle Passage, Campos-Pons continues to recall and honor the struggle, pain, and survival of her African ancestors through these multimedia presentations in photography, sculpture, and performance. And if you want to find out more about the show, the Peabody Essex Museum did an amazing job with their online catalog, where you can go, you can just say, Peabody Essex Museum, Alchemy of the Soul. There are interactive videos, there are sound pieces that allow you to actually hear some of these interviews and some of these interventions that takes place in Cuba.
In the town, nothing is similar to what I was here. So many things have been transformed here, and so many things in the same way stay the same. Sugar, in his own transformation from the sugar field that are surrounding this red soil that I'm standing now, and when the sugar grow, to the run, the core, the essence stay there. In the same way that when I'm here, I feel like not only the core of my own identity is still the same, I am a Guajira. Yo soy una campesina. Yo soy, my feet are red forever because I'm born here.
I don't know, every time I see this video, I think for so many of us, we get that understanding, that connection to wherever we're from, for better or worse, that here a woman who is really known globally understands her place is in the red soil of La Vega. And so what I'm going to do now is just go back a little bit and give some historiography about the region of Matanzas and the place of sugar in that area. So toward the end of the 18th century, following the outbreak of war in Haiti in 1791 and Haiti's declaration of independence from France in 1804, the collapse of its sugar plantation economy led to the expansion of Cuba's own production. Enslaved Africans in Cuba prior to 1790 only comprised a small proportion of the population. By 1811, so that's not a long time, about 20 years, more than 320,000 blacks and mulattoes, or mixed race people, the mulattoes being a derogatory term for people of mixed race, 320,000 Black and mixed race people lived in Cuba, accounting for more than 54% of the population of Cuba. So from 1790 until 1839, the colony's wealth increased by 50%. La Vega, owned by Tirso Mesa y Hernandez, operated as a sugar mill from 1880 to 1888, continuing after the abolition of slavery in 1886 and through the Cuban-Spanish-American War. In 1896, insurgents burned down Tirso Mesa's family house while they were in Puerto Rico on their way back home from Europe. He died in 1908, but he had secured his family's wealth years before by becoming a United States citizen and donating money to the insurgency as, quote, it had become quite clear that the arc of history was bending away from the Spanish Empire. By the time of the revolution in 1959, the people of La Vega were forced to live in the barracones, or the barracks, because Fidel Castro converted them into public housing, where generations of Campos-Pons' family members had been enslaved. Previously, Campos-Pons' family owned a home in the city of Colón while maintaining a farm in La Vega, which they were forced to surrender to the Cuban government. The Safra de los 10 Millones, or Harvest of 10 Million, a plan to harvest sugar to pay off debts to the Soviet Union and to stimulate the economy, began in 1970. The country did not reach its goal, and as a result, Cuban sugar production slumped back into a long decline, leaving the landscape of La Vega increasingly haunted by the spectral presence of desiccated machines, twisting railroad tracks, and crumbling smokestacks, the all too concrete ghosts left behind by immense mountains of sugar that were never produced. The decline of La Vega thereafter left a traumatic economic, physical, and psychological mark on the landscape and its people. As Campos-Pons told Joshua Bosechis, who was the curator of the Alchemy of the Soul show at the Peabody Essex, she said, there's something almost ancestral in the bones for me about the implications associated with sugar production. As the quote states, every lump of sugar is produced by the sweat of some individual. An explanation of the inner workings of sugar plantations under slavery throughout the Caribbean and South America, especially in Cuba and Brazil, clarifies how Campos-Pons manages to distill pain from the ruins of the ingenio, or plant, and its now hidden cruel past that continues to plague Campos-Pons' memory. She says, and this was in, she had a show at Smith College in 2010 on sugar. She says, my perception of sugar has to do with my personal associations with it, as well as seeing it as part of a larger narrative. I am not a consumer of sugar. I don't eat candies. I never add sugar to anything I eat. Maybe this is a negation of sorts, but I've had an aversion to sugar all my life. Even as a child, I didn't like sugar. My mother remembers there was a time when she would try to give me sugar water, and I would cry. Sugar makes me cry. A photograph of Campos-Pons standing before the large, overwhelming skeletal remains of the plant of Sergio Gonzalez for harvesting sugar in Limonar Matanzas, which is in La Vega, evocatively portrays the specter of the monumentality of the ruins of sugar production in Cuba. For the show, on the ground floor of the Peabody Essex Museum, Campos-Pons recreated to scale a model of the plant ruins to usher viewers into a Matanzas-like environment. Campos-Pons' installation provides a skeleton of the memory of the sugar factories within the galleries themselves. And I should say, what you're seeing here is the entrance on the first floor that leads up to the second floor. And this section in particular was had a lot to do with Neil Leonard's intervention. Visitors are greeted with a faint, sweet rum scent as they hear Leonard's 8-channel soundscape with voices and tones, I'll play that shortly, including the signature sound of the clave in rumba music that fades into the sound of rum flowing through and dripping within glass vessels within the gallery. In effect, everyone is made to hear the sounds of the docks, to feel the faint rhythms of rumba, and to smell the wafts of brown sugar while walking around. Leonard wants the sound to complement the glass sculptures appropriately such that he strikes the right sonic and emotional tone within the gallery. Leonard reflected on the aural component, saying, one of the things the piece was intended to evoke, which sort of came out intuitively, was how sounds migrated from Africa. In Cuba, the songs are transformed. Some sung in Spanish, some are secular, sacred things that happened in Cuba that didn't happen in Africa. They migrate like a spirit in one direction. And so what happened then was when you arrived at this elevator, you can see here where there's a pile of sacks of sugar there, and it was deliberate because you wanted to get a sense of what it meant to have to be at the docks and to have these huge mounds of sugar, many of which were heading towards Massachusetts in exchange for other items. And he wanted people to feel like they were at the sugar factory, that they were at the docks. And so the entryway to the elevator and onto the second floor evoked Cuba and the sugar production to its fullest. And in order to do that, he actually asked, I'm gonna forget his name, which is on a different page, Navarro Pujado, who was one of the greatest Afro-Cuban rumba singers, and encouraged the singer to perform songs that he learned as a child hauling sugar sacks at the port. And so he had a vinyl record player, and you can see that here inside of the elevator. So there was an attendant here that stood there, and when you went up, you heard side A, and on your way back down, you heard sound B. And you heard the voice of Navarro Pujado.
Pero que ese es un número que decía, mamita oye, yepero, mamita oye, yepero, yo siento el eco de su voz, yo siento el eco de su voz, por ahí anda, yepero, pon así yo traigo, señora, pon así yo traigo, señora. Rompe Saragüey para los brotes, vete y ve para el que nos ve, vete y ve para el que nos ve, y con esa hierba se cura usted, y con esa hierba se cura usted, hierbero, hierbero, hierbero. Mamita se va el yerbero, llámalo, llámalo. Mamita, yo soy el yerbero, llámalo, llámalo. Yo traigo la vaca, Juan Santa, llámalo, llámalo. Para la gente que son flacas, llámalo, llámalo. Mamita se va el yerbero, llámalo, llámalo. Pues voy a ir, que hay pregones.
You get the idea.
Se va, ¿no? No deje que se vaya, llámalo. Para comprarle hierba. Y todas esas.
So that's the kind of song that would be sung at the docks, so that you're going to the docks, people are hauling sugar, but at the same time, you're hearing songs to keep the work going and to kind of keep people entertained. And so Neil then took that, those soundtracks, and played it on.
Entonces siempre estaban cantando ellos. Decían, Sevillana, Cruz de Mayo, Sevillana que a mi patria levantó. Yo quisiera verte ahora como la primera vez, sevillana Cruz de Mayo, sevillana que mi patria levantó, sevillana.
I could listen to his voice literally all day. To give, I'm going to come back to Magda in a minute, but to give you a sense of Neil's background, he first traveled to Matanzas in 1988 before he met Magda. And he had heard one or two of the members of Los Muñequitos de Matanzas perform live. And he published an article in 1994 called Los Muñequitos, Living Legacy of Africa in Rhythm Music Magazine. And he provided a very brief historical context for the African indigenous roots of the culture of the band. And it was then that during that first sojourn and his many, many returns, he began to play with the band. He's actually pretty known in Cuba, in especially within rumba circles. He plays, Neil Leonard is actually the director of electronic music at Berklee School, at Berklee in Cambridge, in Boston. And he, with his full name is Rafael El Niño Navarro Pujada, he was able to go to his living room, make these recordings, get him to kind of recreate for those listeners, essentially, in, at the Peabody Essex Museum, to get them to kind of be right there in the moment. Rumba, just to give a little bit of history on rumba, it was declared the national dance after the 1959 Cuban Revolution, and Los Muñequitos de Matanzas were among the most celebrated bands by that time. Rumba developed in the poor black communities of Havana and Matanzas in the mid-19th century. As musician and musicologist Ned Sublett surmises, rumba is like the blues. The blues grew out of what W.E.B. Du Bois called the sorrow songs, the spirituals, under these work songs of black Americans that transformed dominant forms of Western music. And similarly, Sublett proclaims, quote, "Rumba is a synthetic Cuban tradition in which one can feel the creativity of Africans adapting themselves to their Hispanic surroundings." And so Sublett explains further that around the loading docks of Havana and Matanzas, the rumberos, or the percussionists, created instruments from the materials that surrounded them. So they used things like wooden drawers, spoons, tabletops, bottles, sticks, or even the walls, because they had to do this, they had to get rid of drums at certain points in time. They were kind of back and forth on whether you could play drums. So you can't play drums, then you get a cart. And often the crates that traveled from the harbors of places like specifically Salem, Massachusetts. Salem and Boston ports were known for carrying bacalao or dried salted codfish to feed enslaved Africans throughout the Caribbean and in Cuba specifically. And some of you will recall Watson and the Shark. That famous, for those art history folks out there, the museum, John Singleton Copley's painting of Watson and the Shark takes place in the Havana Harbor. So that's sort of what those boats you see in the background, that's what they're carrying. They're carrying sugar to the US and other parts of the world. And from Boston, because of the codfish population, was the place to get bacalao. I like calling it bacalao over dried salted codfish. and after the issuance of April 6, 1900 decree by the Havana mayor forbidding Africans instruments, the rumba de cajon, or the box rumba, developed in response. And so they're taking those crates, they're reusing those crates that are coming in from Massachusetts and other places, but a lot from Massachusetts, in order to bypass these laws of outlawing drumming, as I mentioned before. And Sublett also poetically states, quote, they did the same thing to those boxes that they had done to their African culture. They took them apart and put them back together tighter than before. And those are the sounds that Leonard captures from the docks and the sounds and the rhythms he recorded for the elevator and also for the sounds he recorded within the actual galleries. Mm-hmm. not going to be able to play out the whole song and sounds, but essentially, Neil is a trumpeter. He also does electronic music. What you're hearing now is Cienega Zapata from his album Matanzas that was published or released in 2016. So as you were moving through the gallery space, these were the sounds that you would hear. You'd also hear eventually the sound of the water nearby that he recorded. So when you're there, you're hearing music, you might hear voices, you might hear the animals that are nearby in order to kind of, again, recreate a sense of being in Matanzas. So remember, you're going through that huge ruin of the sugar factory into the elevator with the sugar sacks, and then up into the space here. He eventually used the sounds for an installation as a part of Documenta 14. And here you can hear the more environmental sounds. This installation was actually in Athens, Greece. And it was the first time that that Documenta 14, which takes place in Kassel every 10 years? Five years. It was the first time it took place in Athens, and it just so happens that Matanzas is called the Athens of Cuba. And so they also installed these beautiful glass sculptures, and I'll talk about them in a second, as a way of hearkening to the ruins once again, to cristal, and cristal is often referred as a kind of sugar that is also means glass. And so she's still, even though this doesn't look like sugar, it's a kind of noting of sugar nevertheless. And so in Athens, they're doing this work, and then also in Kassel, again, first at the Peabody Essex Museum. And I wanted to switch a little bit over to Magda's inspiration for these glass orbs, and I'll talk a little bit more at length about them. She was inspired by Remedios Varo, who was a Spanish-born Mexican citizen and was really heralded in Mexico. And so the name of the performance is called Remedios or Remedies, but also refers to Remedios Varo specifically. And what you see here is the painting that really is the one that kind of shows the complexity by which Varos was able to get to a kind of alchemy. It's very scientific, the creation of the birds. And it's about a sugar laborer, or the performance that Magda eventually takes on is about a sugar laborer that then turns into an owl woman. And I'll go back to that video that I was showing that is about the kind of creation of the birds as a process of creating art. What does it mean to take the light from that window to transpose it onto the surface of the paper and essentially make an alchemic or a magical transformation? That's what I think artists do, is that they make something really from just what they have before them. And so the creation of this new life, visual life, be it or musical or oral life as well. And I think in so many times, and so here is where you get the most kind of direct relation to that painting and what Magda does here. These glass sculptures were commissioned by the Peabody Essex Museum, and it is called Alchemy of the Soul, Elixir of the Spirit. And so these are owned by the Peabody Essex Museum. I haven't been yet, but they have one of the glass sculptures out for viewing. If you make it there and see the new installation of the museum, you can get a sense of what that looks like and the kind of power that it holds. And I mentioned before that glass and sugar really do have a resonance for what Magda wanted to do. I'm going to play very quickly a clip by Magda, once again recorded for the show.
So alchemy, when I'm thinking about alchemy of the soul, I am thinking too about the kind of a very deep transformative process that takes place with sugar production from the moment that sugar is planted in the field to the moment in which sugar, in its latest form of transformation as a ron, become this kind of a golden, beautiful, crystal clear liquid.
So the idea of taking sugar from canes, very green canes, to processing it through severe working conditions, especially before the sugar process, the sugar processing process was industrialized. And in a couple of the classes, my African diaspora class, as well as the Global Americas class that I co-teach with Jay Oles, we talk a lot about the process of sugar, what that looked like, the kind of dangers that people faced, and on plantations such as the Ingenio Tinguaro, which this is an early depiction of it, of those ruins that I showed you earlier. But working in the harvesting these sugar cane was grueling work, and it caused, of course, loss of limbs was probably the most common danger people face, but certainly, of course, it's just the extreme conditions of working sun up to sun down, the disintegration of families, and how do you keep families bonded when you are kind of exhausted from the day, right? And what is distinctive about the enslaved population for Cuba is the fact that because they went very late in the 19th century with slavery, they had a very large population of Yoruba who occupied these plantations. So there was a kind of kinship among the enslaved people there, which again was, I mean, if you can have something to hold on to, that's at least one bonus. Now, for the actual performance, Remedios, you get a sense that in this, I'm just showing you a clip, and I'll go back to the original performance that I showed you that you were looking at initially. Here you have an Afro-Cuban protagonist. You'll notice a few things. She's wearing a green dress. Everything is intentional, right? So her dress is as green as the green cane stalks that you'll see from the video shortly. You'll hear her repeat kind of angrily as she hacks at the cane in frustration with her place in Cuba, frustration with the kind of loss of life and of property, right? I mentioned that they owned more property that got taken over by the Cuban government, but she shouts out, sugar, and you'll hear her continue to say, sugar, sugar. And that frustration comes from that struggle to remedy, the finding un remedio, the injustice of enslavement, sugar, the fraction of the family, sugar, and the repression of African culture, sugar. And there are no answers that are provided by the vocalization and the obstructions of progress of Afro-Cuban women you might not be able to put your hand on it, right? But the catharsis settles in for both the artists and her audience as they are both asked to contend with the seemingly innocuous substance of sugar. So I'm just gonna come back out here to the video. So I was present for this. This is not my video, this is the museum's. And I had my daughter with me, which was really fun. And also, I have to give a shout out to Jasmine Kaimick, who's class of 16, I think. She now writes for The Stranger in Seattle, if for those of you familiar with that. She was a history major who I adopted as an art history major, and she actually does art reviews for The Stranger. She was there, Irene Mata was there as well, and it was powerful to be there. So we weren't up here on the balcony, we were down there where you saw that photograph previously. So this is a scene where she starts hacking at the canes with the machete.
Here in the town of Salem, what business does she have? What business does she have to being here in this place talking about sugar, sugar, the bitter sugar, the sweet sugar, the abuse of our body, sugar, the empire of the capitalism, sugar, this terrible history that come all the way with my ancestor, sugar. But I wonder, have I been here before? Did I ever was here before? What business do I have in this town of Salem? Did I have been before, mother? Do you remember? Is any history of sugar from the town of Matanza arriving particular in this town of Salem from port to port? I was wondering always, what kind of energy, what kind of resilience, how we manage to do that done? How in the world is possible to get from 12 hours of slave, the working in the field, to come to the house and love anybody? What love is left for us? What love is left in the world for somebody who is cast in the shed, in the sun from morning to night to go home and do something else? Sugar, I was here before? Did I? Oh, I lost my glasses. I looking clear? Is this that I recognize? Do I recognize myself? I don't know. Mother, sugar, con permiso, gun. Rum, rum, rum.
I'm just gonna silence this for a minute. Just so you know, in Salem, in the Boston area, there were at least 40 rum distilleries. Boston was a major site for rum production. So when she's saying sugar to rum, I know you don't wanna miss this. So when she's saying sugar to rum, that sugar is being hacked from the plantations of Cuba, from Matanzas, which had the largest population of enslaved Africans, packed in those sacks, put at the docks, placed on the boats in exchange for the bacalao that has arrived to continue to feed the enslaved Africans. The ships go to Boston. They get distributed here to places that dot all around Salem, around Boston, so that there is rum to be distributed throughout the country as well as abroad. So this is an epicenter for the sugar and rum production. And we often, as slavery is taught, it's often missed the key role that not only Boston, Massachusetts, but also Rhode Island played in the slave trade. Without Boston, you're missing actually a huge loop in that circle, triangle, quadrilateral, whatever, you know, that Boston in this area, New England, plays a critical role in what happens in the Caribbean, along with the tea sets, the fine tea sets you might see in Boston, MFA. So all of these things you can kind of, you can have a cookie after, don't worry. I feel like no one's like, I shouldn't eat sugar. But this is what needs to be kind of, this is what she's attempting to do in bringing you an awareness that a performance can do in a way that just looking at a photograph of sugar or looking at a still of a performance. So why
being in the son of the master, how in the world, how do my ancestors manage sugar is squeezed out of my body, making in drawn, taking in liquid, but out of my pure blood. Try it. Sugar, that sweet, delicious liquid. Try.
Over
sugar. From where the richness of the war in the America was built, taken out day by day from the blood of my ancestors. Try sugar, that delicious, wonderful product, crystal, but crystal that was squeezed out of my body, out of the body that people I love. Sugar, but we did not get bitter, we did not get angry, we build the country, we build the empire. Alchemy, yes, like alchemy, we did wonders, wonders out of suffering, and we still smile, yes, we still smile, we are still happy. Sugar, try. Smile of the.
So you get the idea. She's handing out the sugar. She's making you think like sugar, and she's continuing to talk sugar. So it's interrupting what you think of sugar, right? It's sugar's ubiquitous in this country, right? And so being able to have, I remember the first time when I was a kid, because I grew up with people from the Caribbean, specifically from Puerto Rico, I didn't realize that there was a sugar cane. Right, so many of us don't even understand where the sugar comes from. And I know my son was fascinated by it himself. So there's also rum being served. At one point, the performance artist Del Hamilton is passing around a tray of small sugar slices. Right, this idea of serving and how do you consume your sugar. I'm gonna fast forward a little bit. This is 35 minutes long, so I cannot play it all. But to the part where she transforms herself into an owl. I actually have interviewed Magda on a number of occasions and asked her about owls and sort of what they mean. They're often considered, we kind of understand them as wise. Sometimes they can be viewed as a premonition, good or bad. And she grew up, in where she grew up, there were flocks of owls. She said she could walk outside and they'd just be all around her, which I think is another kind of mystical thing that happens and is really quite powerful. So here is Magda, and she sets herself up like that Remedios Varo painting. She's at a desk and she's creating. And she has a young girl who happens to be the daughter of an alum, Cheryl Findlay, who's an art historian. and so there is a way in which she is reenacting and making that painting come alive.
I could see much clear now.
Another
incantation. I could see much clear now,
well.
Mother. I could see much clear now. I could see much clear now. Oshosi. Con permiso, Oshosi.
So she's calling out various orishas or gods, deities.
Con permiso, Oshosi.
Asking their permission to call their names to be involved in this ritual performance.
I could see much clear now.
And Oshosi is often represented as a bird.
La ela ye como de moda. I could see much clear now.
What she winds up doing with this space.
How should I burn emotion? I could see much clearer now. I could see much clearer now. Yeah.
clear now, mother.
So then she makes projections onto the wall, so the owls actually wind up taking flight onto the wall.
That's really crystal.
It was powerful.
But I could see much clear now.
Okay.
Do you remember?
I'm just going to show one other artist that I feature in my book as well. And I don't have time to talk about the Castle performance, but I very early on realized that I had to do something with Dulce Alegre Cruz, whose hook is
Alegre como el tambor. Llevo el rítmico tumbao, llevo el rítmico tumbao de África en el corazón. Hija de una isla rica, esclava de una sonrisa, soy calle y soy carnaval. Calle, corazón y tierra, mi sangre es azúcar negra, es amor y es música. Azúcar, azúcar.
Okay, so this idea, the daughter of a rich land, slave of a sunrise, I'm the street, I'm carnival, my blood is brown sugar. And certainly Celia Cruz has her own history, and I think that bringing her together with Magda's own investigation of sugar has been really, really helpful for me, and thinking about how she does, in fact, make for a very interesting, a critical case in understanding how her insertion into the music industry as someone who was fully accepted as, yes, Cubana, but also very proudly Black, and proclaiming azúcar negra literally means black sugar, which is understood as brown sugar. Right, this understanding of her body as both as Cuban, but as a black woman who even in the 70s kind of takes on some American, some black American understandings, wearing kente and having an afro and understanding the kind of diasporic unity of blackness in that way. Again, I have a lot to say about all of this that you'll be able to read one day in my book. But I'll end here with just a summary of some of what I've been doing and thinking about the carnivalesque and thinking about how Cuba plays a role in understanding another paradigm for blackness. And Magda Campos-Pons's portraits I see in her performance, if it's as the Guggenheim, as I mentioned, or if it's as a laborer in the fields. As someone who there's a lot of improvisation involved. I've seen her scurry for items minutes before a performance, but she's always ready and constantly thinking about for weeks and months and years about some of these ideas. And excuse me. And I think her motivation really of expanding her home region into a broader context for thinking about issues such as the African slave trade, the understanding that Matanzas, her, as a Guajira, someone who is really connected to the earth, that she is invested in making sure that her presence, her body as a black woman, as a Cubana, as a person of the diaspora is fully felt. And Matanza, and I'll just quote her here in saying that she says, it's always been a special place, Matanzas, that I love to come home to for inspiration and restorative energy. Matanzas is full of gifted and talented artists, poets, philosophers, and other creatives, but they have never received the global recognition that they deserve. This is an opportunity to use my expertise as an artist and as an educator to give back to a place that has done so much for me. And I think by extension, Magda, at least for my career, has done so much for me in understanding both her place as a black woman in Cuba, but ultimately, I'll be honest, as for me, in my place as a black American woman here in the United States, and more specifically at in Wellesley, Massachusetts. So thank you so much for your attention. And if you have any questions, I welcome them. It is not easy summarizing parts of your book. Yes, please. Yeah.
I have two questions.
Sure.
I forgot the performer's name, but the first is that the performer's costume, the first one is a green that you said is similar to the plants, but it's also similar to the Cuban military's uniform.
Oh, color. Right.
So
oh, good.
If you could talk about that. And the second question is, I noticed sometimes you use Afro-Cuban, and also you talked about like as a black woman. I was wondering why you might use Afro-Cuban and not like black Cubans or Cuban and black, if those mean anything.
Okay, I appreciate that. Well, I actually initially my book was going to be African American art before I included her, and decided to change it to black art in order to encompass it. I use Afro-Cuban because that is the parlance of identifying people of African descent in Cuba. But it is one that I think if you're thinking of that, it's something I need to make sure I address in the book. And in sort of along those lines, one of the big questions that I've had to contend with is whether to capitalize black or lowercase black. And I've asked so many people, I've looked at different sources, what are people doing? I see it both ways. Right now, it's not capitalized, and I feel like I still don't have a good reason for it, but I think that I'm going to have to come up with one for my notes pretty soon here. I'm waiting to see what the editors say about what I do have so far, but those are good questions. I've had to really think about the terminology of referring to people of African descent, and I either say people of African descent or black as a way to encompass us all. Any other questions? Yes,
Sarah. Oh, and if students or other people have that question, I want to give them to
it's,
you. Okay, so I'm a literary scholar, but it
yes.
seems to me that NMCP, as I've been writing in my notes.
That's how I do it in my notes too.
There's a lot of attention to words and to the way that words are overlap and can be used for different things. Mm-hmm. I was in her, especially in her performance where she's hacking sugarcane while, as you said, interjecting the word sugar,
mm-hmm.
and she's talking to the audience and repeating this, as you say, interrupting her own statements with this interjection of sugar.
Mm-hmm.
It made me think of all the ways that as an American English speaker, the word, especially as an American English speaker growing up in the Southeast, growing up in the South Atlantic, in North Carolina, where I'm from,
mm-hmm.
how the word sugar means is often used as a euphemism for shit, right? It's what parents say, oh, sugar, right? That happened.
Yeah.
The fact that it's used as a colloquialism for diabetes. He has problems with his sugar.
Yeah.
You know, he has to go to the doctor because of his sugar.
Mm-hmm.
That's another way in which obviously sugar has impacted upon the bodies, and particularly the bodies of poor people, right? Because type 2 diabetes is often a disease of poverty. It's a really to alchemy. The big sugar in my blood, right? The diabetes being the most sugar. It's that alchemy is turning something into something,
mm-hmm.
and the fact that when you have type 2 diabetes, your body loses gradually the ability to turn sugar into insulin, right? It's something that results from eating too much sugar, but it also means that your body's often able to process and
mm-hmm.
alchemize sugar into energy, right? So so those are some things. And also obviously this is not, I think it's originally from the Southeast, but it's not only the Southeast, but the euphemism, the use of sugar as a colloquialism for love, right? Give me some sugar.
Sugar, yeah.
Right.
How you doing, sugar?
Exactly, yeah, but like specifically as a quantity, you know, like
yeah.
give me some sugar, meaning give me a kiss, right? Something that grandmothers say.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I just think all the things that all the things that sugar means in American English,
mm-hmm.
besides the substance. and related to the way that it can be, you have the alchemy vessels in the center on this frame, the way that alchemy turns one substance into another, or turns lead into gold, or
right, liquid into solid, or the other way around. And what's interesting too in terms of diabetes is that as a result of the last 20 to 30 years of the increase in processed food in the Caribbean, you know, a place where they relied much more heavily on fruits and vegetables that were grown in the yards, that the surge of diabetes throughout the Caribbean is catastrophic at this point, and reaching epidemic levels. And I think that there's something to the kind of the presumed innocuousness of sugar that over time can literally kill you, right? And from the beginning, sugar killed people, right? If they killed them in the on the plantations, then they killed them with the alcoholism once they got here, right? So yeah, I think the danger of sugar, the bittersweetness, I guess that's the bittersweetness of it, right? That it can taste so good and have these histories attached to it and severe consequences as well. Yeah, thank you, I appreciate that.
Oh, just to piggyback off this, the notion that sugar kills, please tell me in your book you are footnoting the great Boston molasses flood disaster of 1919.
Oh, shoot, I did not put that in, but
also,
I will.
Also known, I'm not making this up, the Boston Molassacre, in which I think 20-some people died. In the North End in Boston, there was a molasses factory.
Right,
I can't remember what
right.
happened. But tidal waves of molasses poured
right.
into the streets. 21 people drowned in molasses. Carriage horses drowned in molasses. But it's one of the great disastrous pieces. And since you traveled with us from Puerto Rico to Cuba, the Guggenheim,
yeah.
And then back to Peabody, Essex, and also Boston, that's such a powerful Boston anecdote. You know? Anyway,
yeah.
And you also ended with Celia Cruz and molasses. So.
Mm-hmm. I'm supposed to be finishing this chapter, Elena. I mean, I am finished. I don't want to put anything else, but I will put that in. Oh, no. Yes, Laura. Oh, no, Kai.
So I was wondering with MMCPs, like the, like in her, in the performance that you showed in the museum that you were at, I noticed, I don't know if I'm like, if I missed something or if it wasn't shown like mm-hmm. within the video, like with who exactly she's giving the sugar to.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was just like, well, there's was a more like white population there, but like, I just thought of like the connotations of who's being given. But there was also like, I think like an agent that was giving sugar, so it might just be like for everyone, but it was interesting like who's being given this to represent what she means.
That's a good eye, Kayla. Yeah, I noticed it too, that she really is, I'm gonna put it on mute, but she is definitely distributing that to very specific people. I don't know if, of course this is a white audience, I should say, it's a large proportion of the people are white. This is the opening, and that's my daughter in the striped shirt. I wasn't sure whether she'd be afraid as she's walking down with, you know, a machete and cane. And she actually, at one point, I don't know if it played, where she starts to consume the rum and spit it out as if in ritual. So that activates the space as well. But yeah, she does pass it out to, that's Jasmine right there. She had a choice between, there's Irene. With long hair. She had a choice between Jasmine and the white male next to her, and she's like, oh yeah, you. So I think you're right. I think you picked up on that correctly.
Laura.
Well, my comment kind of relates to that insofar as like I appreciate the juxtaposition between Celia Cruz and this performance, because
mm-hmm.
Celia Cruz is a black woman, like a black Cuban woman, but she is beloved like across races in Cuba, right? She's like
yes.
a Cuban icon.
Yes.
And there's this myth that like racism doesn't exist in Cuba, but
yes.
it is a myth, like obscured by histories or whatever, like,
absolutely.
You know. So I appreciate the idea of, like, who's consuming Black culture or Black Cuban culture. It's not an appreciation of Black Cubans themselves or a concern for their social mobility or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
It's
mm-hmm.
about what we consume from what they produce.
I 100% agree with your analysis. That's all there. And even in the scholarship on Celia Cruz, there are a couple of camps where she's sort of like, I'm not, there are times where she does not wholeheartedly embrace her Blackness. That it's kind of, or she tries to, at times, not mention it, that she's Cuban. That doesn't matter, which is absolutely a part of the mythology within Cuba. And I remember going there and very surreptitiously, carefully interviewing a Afro-Cuban rapper and asking him a question like, so does racismo exist here? And he's like, see. He just went on and on and on and on, because once you start looking at who gets what jobs and their living conditions, that you do start to see the hierarchy and the stratification within the society, while also fully, and this was a part of Fidel Castro's push of embracing African identity in a way that hadn't happened beforehand. And it's a real, it's a paradox of Fidel Castro, of this, you know, yes, we all are African and we can embrace that, but then also understanding that there was still a preference for a white skin, and you're taking the barracks and converting them into public housing. So it's a lot there.
So this is building a bit on your very good point, but probably it's just because I've been in a lot of museums lately, and I have nothing to do with art
mm-hmm.
as my discipline. But this question is also for Irene. The question of performance, and we've talked a lot about the body and space, the space of the body, but
mm-hmm.
there's also the question of time. And when you're going to experience performance in real time, I mean, that's an amazing thing. But if these are museums, these are hostile spaces, as we know from her wearing the Guggenheim, that's the best moment, was just seeing
yeah.
that. But how the question I have is about preservation of these performances, and how both you and Irene study in performance art that is doing,
mm-hmm.
entering spaces that have been traditionally controlled by an elite white majority. What happens to these performances going forward?
You're seeing it. That's what this is what you get, is the
mm-hmm.
recording
okay.
of it.
Okay.
When she did the Identify performance in Washington, D.C., one of my good friends is the curator of painting and drawings at the National Portrait Gallery, and initiated this series of performances portraiture. And so she invited Magda to participate, and she is trying to, one of the things she tried to do was to keep the dress. And it's funny because when I asked Magda, I said, okay, I'm finishing this essay, I need to know what the name of the dress is. And she's like, the name of the dress. What do you think the name of the dress should be? I'm thinking, so there's a way in which she has to now think about, she didn't even think to name the dress. So I basically pushed her for a name, and she winded up naming it after her mother. So it's called the Guggenheim dress, that is. It's called the Estrovina dress. And so that is going to be part of what we do with performance art. Can you save some of the sugar pieces and the dress? I mean, there's not necessarily a great interest in it. I don't think the National Portrait Gallery, I don't know if they bought the costume that was made for Identified, and I don't know who owns or whether, I don't think the Guggenheim's interested in the Guggenheim dress, for example. I don't think so, and it's definitely the first time anyone had tried that, and I should give props too. I interviewed the costume designer, who was Zinda Williams, and she did the Guggenheim dress, and she did the dress for the Identified performance in D.C., She is actually, she was a costume designer for the Alvin Ailey dance program, and she did that whole lot. And she worked with a lot of designers ahead of time. Now she's an independent designer. And it was interesting getting her story, because those are, I mean, that's all a part of making this happen. And how I saw it too is that here are all of these often Black women who are involved with making the performance happen. A lot of the people who are in her performance, who are in the entourage of her performance, they're often, some of them are her students, her former students from the Museum School of Boston. I didn't mention that she taught here, taught in Boston for a long time. She's at Vanderbilt now. And so she often surrounds herself with Black and Latinx people who are also a part of the performance. And so that extends this conversation of how, yeah, the circle of Black feminism and how you can kind of make a performance stretch out and be much more within the museum space. I was hoping that I would get my Museums Are Not Neutral t-shirt in time. It's gonna be coming later in the week. But I think a key part of this is just injecting, I keep saying injecting, almost forcing ourselves into museums. I think that in and of itself is an intervention that hasn't happened consistently, but it's happening more. I'm not saying she's the first. There's certainly many artists throughout the 20th century who have been doing that, and more documentation is coming on it. Any other questions? Well, thank, oh, one more, sure.
You just mentioned where she is right now, which partly answered the question I had, which was, I was really struck by the interplay between sort of the rootedness and, you know, the soil, that on the one hand, and the fact that in that performance she's sort of forcing audience to grapple with the travel, right, over the distance.
Yeah.
And, but that made me wonder about sort of her place as you see it. Sort of, how much of her is she a Cuban artist as opposed to an international artist? And, you know, as she does these performances in various venues, and you said, you know, as you just said, from Boston to Vanderbilt to,
yeah.
I just really wondered about sort of how you see her sort of placedness, or sort of how, right, how she comes into being in that sort of interplay between being rooted and
being elsewhere, being a global citizen. I think she simultaneously exists in both, right? I think about the moniker or the naming of people of African descent in the United States as African American. I am many generations away from my ancestors actually from Africa. But there's a sense that there is a rootedness there despite the time. And I think for her, she is actually doing a lot of reinvesting into the arts of Matanzas in particular. So this past spring, with the mounting of the 13th Habana Biennial, she really pushed for Matanzas as a satellite site for the biennial. And she actually invited artists from Black diasporic artists from the United States and elsewhere, and a lot of Matanzas-born artists to present there. Winded up not being able to go. I wish I could give you on the ground information, but there was a focus on how can the arts, even beyond Havana, be represented. And so she's doing that constantly. So she goes back quite a bit in a way, it's keeping herself connected, and she still has family there. But I think with that said, she is definitely a global citizen, a global artist, and does spend most of her time in the US. And I think that happens for any artist that leaves home. One of the questions I ask in class when we're doing introductions, I say, where do you call home? Because that's a whole different question, right? I've been in Massachusetts for 8 years, but I'm a Jersey girl, right? Oh, you were raising your hand because you are also a Jersey girl. You get it. You're still a Jersey girl.
So I don't have a question. I just wanted to make a comment because I'm such a big fan of your work and the ways in which you read this
performance especially, I just found so astounding, even as we stood there together and you were telling me, because you were thinking through so many of these issues as we were standing there, and I was just so floored by it. But I also think it's really important to acknowledge the intervention that you, as an art historian, you're making. In the same ways in which Magda is making these interventions in museums, you're making these interventions in the scholarship, because so few people are actually writing about performance art. Because it's very difficult to write about something that oftentimes is very ephemeral, right? It's there in the moment and then it's gone. And as someone who is now making that transition to writing about performance art, it is incredibly difficult to figure out where you position the work, because we come from very traditional disciplines, right? And so trying to find the site of analysis and trying to explain that in a text, right? It's so difficult. And so I just want to acknowledge the interventions that you're also making your scholarship.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I appreciate that, Irene. It is very hard. thank you all. Thanks for sticking it out for the Q&A, and I appreciate your attention. And if you have any comments or questions, please email me, talk to me. I still have a little bit of time. I got about a week before this thing gets going to Duke. So please, anything you want to say, say it now or forever hold your peace. Take care.